just a minute. Start. Let's start.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A big welcome from Sikkim Manipal Institute of Technology for another webinar. And this time, we have a webinar from the world of nanotechnology. We had a total registration of 1,048 from every corner of the country. The schedule today, we start with SMIT video, followed by a short video on nanotechnology. And the inaugural session will be followed with Professor Nayan Bhattacharya, after which speakers will be introduced, and then they will carry forward the webinar with session one, followed by session two. So here is a short video of our beautiful campus. Ladies and gentlemen, enjoy the video.
The intellectual aspirations of the students. SMIT has a sound institutional and nurturing emotional strength, healthy mind-body, and resilience amongst the students. Our mission is to develop SMIT into an institution of excellence, capable of producing competent techno-managers who can contribute effectively advancement.
A very short video on nanotechnology to those people who are not familiar with nanotechnology.
Something is nano, we mean it is very small. The size of 1 nanometer is 1 billionth of a meter, which is about 100,000 times smaller than the width of a human hair. Making new things at this incredibly small scale is called nanotechnology, and it's one of the most exciting and fast-moving areas of science today. Some nanomaterials are naturally occurring. You can find them everywhere, in volcanic ash, ocean spray, fine sand, and dust. Naturally occurring nanostructures are also present in plants and animals. For example, nanostructures in insect eyes ensure an anti-reflection and water-repelling effect, so they can fly safely. Nowadays, scientists can create nanostructures themselves. By rearranging the atoms of an object, they can make new nanomaterial with new properties. For example, that are stronger, lighter, or different in color.
Thank you.
Properties change also according to their size. And this is the magic of the technology. In the food area, researchers are working with nanotechnologies to create novel products that may be of benefit to health and diet. For example, nanosilver has antibacterial properties that can be used in food contact material, such as cutting boards. In food supplements, nano-sized carriers increase absorption of nutrients. Nanosensors can be incorporated into packaging to monitor the quality and shelf life of food from manufacturers to consumers. It can also make food ingredients tastier or healthier. Carving up a grain of salt into small to make it work.
Dear participants, during the second session of today's webinar, in the chat box, this link will be floated. You have to give your feedback for your certificates. Each one of you will be getting the certificate of participation after you give your feedback for today and for tomorrow. Today's speaker one, we have Dr. W.B. Grunela, and speaker two, Professor Sanjay Dahal from SMIT. I would like to hand over this session to Professor Nayan Kamal Bhattacharya. Thank you.
Good morning to one and all present in this webinar. Professor Sanjay Dahal, Head Department of Chemistry, Sikkim Manipal Institute of Technology. Professor D.V. Prabhu, General Secretary, Association of Chemistry Teachers. Professor Brijesh Pare, President, Association of Chemistry Teachers. Other members of ACT, our speakers, faculty members, other guests, and my dear students. It's my privilege and immense pleasure to introduce the webinar on Advanced Nanotechnology, Versatile Molecule and Spectroscopy. I believe this webinar gives us the opportunity to exchange our ideas and building relationship among scientific community. This webinar is organized by Department of Chemistry, Sikkim Manipal Institute of Technology in association with Association of Chemistry Teachers, Mumbai. We have organized this webinar on 3rd and 4th July, that is today and tomorrow at 11 a.m. Two lectures will be on today and another two will be on tomorrow. Today, the first lecture will be given by Dr. W.B. Gurnela, Associate Professor, Department of Chemistry, Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur. His topic is Nanoscience and its Impact on Society. The second lecture will be given by Professor Sanjay Dahal, Professor and Head Department. Feedback form will be circulated.
विवेक सर कैमरा ऑन कीजिए कैसे
यहां से पर करो
वो तो पीपीटी है सर
आप पीपीटी जाएगी वो फिर आपका फेस नहीं आएगा
ठीक है इसके बाद संजय जाएगा ना
प्रोफेसर नयन को थोड़ी बोलना यार अब तो बोलती हूँ शेयर नहीं किया क्या हो रहा
है एंड नंबर डॉक्टर विवेक शर्मा
एंड नंबर
थैंक यू सर Our first speaker for the day, Dr. W.B. Gurnela, who is presently working as Associate Professor in Department of Chemistry, Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur, India. So I would like to invite our esteemed speaker to enlighten the house.
Sanjay,
over to you, sir.
Sir, Vivek sir.
Vivek
sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Please welcome Dr. Sanjay Dahal and Dr. Brijesh Pare to welcome the gathering.
Mr. Vivek, please enable your camera, otherwise your contents will not come. Kindly enable your camera, please.
Okay, let me repeat. Good morning to all of you present in this online platform. I am happy that faculty members and students from all over the country have participated in this webinar. I am delighted that Professor Brijesh Parekh, President, Association of Chemistry Teachers, has joined with us. I welcome you, sir. I would like to welcome Professor D.V. Prabhu, General Secretary, Association of Chemistry Teachers, to this webinar again. I welcome all the participants, Association of Chemistry members, faculty members, and especially students from all over the country. I also welcome our speakers, Professor M. Swaminathan from Department of Chemistry, Annamalai University. I welcome Dr. W. B. Gurnela from Department of Chemistry, Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur. I welcome Professor Sumna Chatterjee from Sikkim Manipal Institute of Technology. I do hope that in this pandemic situation, online platform will help all of us to interact and exchange ideas. I must thank my colleague, Dr. N.K. Bhattacharya, coordinator of this webinar, who has done all the hard work for conducting this webinar, and faculty members of our department, SMIT, for providing this platform to the scientific community to come together and exchange ideas. I sincerely believe that all the students are going to benefit from this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to request Professor Brijesh Parekh, President, Association of Chemistry Teachers, to welcome in this online platform.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much, and good morning to all of you. I'm audible to all?
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay,
sir.
Thank you. So I take this opportunity to place on record.
Sir, please switch on your camera.
It is enabled. It is enabled.
Video.
Oh, yeah. Fine. Now it is enabled. Yeah. Okay.
One second.
Yeah, it's enabled.
Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. One second, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
Now you can start, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. So, good morning to all of you. It's a great pleasure and honor to present in the inaugural session of the 2 days webinar on nanotechnology and spectroscopy by the University of Sikkim Manipal, and on behalf of the Association of Chemistry Teachers, Homi Baba Center of Science Education, Mumbai, I welcome all the guests, particularly Professor Sanjay Dahal, Professor and Head Department of Chemistry, University of Sikkim, Professor Nayan Kamal Bhattacharya, who is the Professor of Chemistry, and he is a member of our ACT Executive Council, the National Executive Council, Professor Gurunale, who is a Secretary of Izuchon ACT, and all the faculty members of Department of Chemistry, Sikkim Manipal University, and of course the Director and the Vice Chancellor of the University, for having given this opportunity to collaborate this wonderful program on nanotechnology with Association of Chemistry Teachers. During this lockdown, the webinars are so important, and they are playing very important role in interacting with the students, and I'm very happy to know that across India, many students from undergraduate and postgraduate, they are participating in today's webinar, today's and tomorrow's webinar. And I'm so happy regarding this the topic, that is the nanotechnology. And definitely our speakers will speak more on that elaborately. But, we all know that the discovery of fullerene by Croteau, Kull and Smalley has made this branch possible. And now it is so much functional that in every aspect of our life, it has got tremendous applications, and it is really coming up very fast. Regarding the SCT, we are completing 20 years. And this year, in February, when we met in Homi Baba Center and we had our ECT, our EC meeting, and because of the 28th year, we thought that we'll go for a lot of programs, of popularizing chemistry in particular. But nobody had thought that because of the corona pandemic, we will have to go online only. And since this year, we couldn't do any physical kind of workshops, but mostly we are doing with webinars, and they are going very nicely. And as far as the objectives of SET is concerned, you know, we have a mandate to popularize chemistry, and that we do by doing workshops and conferences across India and even overseas. So once again, I take this opportunity to thank the Sikkim Manipal University Vice Chancellor, Director, and Professor and Head. And of course,
thank you.
Thank you, sir. Our first speaker for the day is Dr. W.B. Gurunilya, Associate Professor, Department of Chemistry at Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur. He has received CRSI Best Teacher Awards 2011 for outstanding contribution in polymer materials presented by Chemical Research Society of India. He obtained his MSc degree in the year 1989, and with over 200 research paper published so far, our speaker for the day is an expert in this field. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure for us to have Dr. Gurunilya as speaker number one. I would like to hand over the proceeding to our speaker number one. Thank you.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Sir, you can start, sir.
Yeah.
You can start, sir.
Thank you, sir, for your brief introduction. First of all, I thanks the organizer for inviting me for this webinar. And for this webinar, now here, organizers, coordinator of this webinar, Professor N.K. Bhattacharya, sir, of SMIT, and Professor Sanjay Dhar, head of the department of the chemistry of this SMIT, Professor Vijesh Pare, president of Association of Chemistry Teachers, and at the outset, I would like to thank Professor D.V. Prabhu, General Secretary of Association of Chemistry Teachers, Mumbai, and esteemed participants and faculty members. Before going to start, I am sharing my screen. Is it visible? Sir, is it visible?
Yes,
okay. So, today I am going to discuss, and the title of the topic is here, Nanoscience and its Impact on the Society. And this topic, this presentation is useful for those doing the research in the material science. And also, today I am giving some basic concept about the nanoscience and nanotechnology. And here, as we know, we are in a now in a modern age of the science, and today we are living in this dynamic world where time domains and geography are rapidly shrinking, but at the same time, there is a innovation and the competitions are as a key drivers. As we know that we are in a knowledge-driven economy, which is linked with the science and technology. Science and technology are different, but at the same time, they are complementary with each other. As we know, what is science? Science is the pursuit of knowledge and understanding for its own sake. And technology is the creation of artifacts for the people needs. And as we know that the development of many technology which make our life comfortable are related to the material. And we know that materials are size dependent. And there is a discipline of material science which is deal with this material. And material engineering, by using this material, designing the different things depending upon the requirement. And as we know that material science and material scientists play an important role in the development of our country. And as we know that material scientists also claim that 21st century is the century of materials, and especially the nanomaterials. And now, before going to discuss detail about that, in the how the industrial revolutions take place, and here as the time progresses.
So kindly press F5 on your screen, sir. Your PPT. The whole screen should come, sir.
Okay.
Sorry to interrupt.
Okay, sir. The screen is total full, na? It is full.
No, sir. Not, sir. No, no, no. Press this one, sir. Or press F5, sir.
It is okay, sir.
Yeah. Now it's okay?
No, sir. Press that, sir. Yes, yes. This one, sir.
It's okay? Sir, is it okay now?
No, sir.
No, sir, is it? Yes, F5, yes, it is full screen.
Sir, you need to click on slideshow.
Now it is okay?
No, sir, your share screen is void. Yeah. Again, it's back.
Sir, you can click on slideshow, sir.
Yeah, slideshow on top.
Okay, now. Okay, sir. So can so now here, as the time changes, there is a industrial revolution in the materials, and so after the some changes are there. After the Middle Age, the steam engine came. After that, railways, automobile, and then after computers. And so next big step after this is the we can say that it is the nanotechnology. So this is the recently developed branch of that is nano materials or nanotechnology. And now see the in a before early days the how the evolution in the nanotechnology was there. So as we know that here how the opportunities are there. Here is the years are given. In 1970, there was a basic research, and day by day now, as the year goes, in 2000 there was an applied research, and so in this way now after we can say that after 2020 we can say that there may be a mass market about this material. And now one scientist is there, that is the Robert Kerr. He says that carbon nanotechnology was the much older as compared to carbon nanoscience, and he has given the in a talk in IICT Hyderabad, and he says that this concept, and also in this conference when he is talking, he also given the talk about the fullerene, and he also got a Nobel Prize for this his work. And this professor Robert Kerr shared the Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1996 for discovery of the fullerene along with the Richard Smalley and Harold Kotto. And they also shows their experimental result that the sword, that is Damocles sword, used by the kings in the old days, that is Maharana Pratap, or the that is so we can say that Tipu Sultan or Shivaji Maharaj, that sword also contain a large number of carbon nanotubes. So and similar thing is also they have observed in case of the glass material which are in the Roman times, and on this material of the glass. And it is covered with the nano materials, but people does not know about these materials from the long time. And now here, these are the two these Lacquer cup, which is kept in the British Museum as a Roman pottery. And here we say the color in a daylight look like this. And designs is there etching on this glass. and this red color is nothing but the red color of the nano size gold. So this is not the modern, but now people are using this nano materials or nanotechnology from the long times. And this about this paper have been published in a Nature in 2000. And this is the one reference is given for this. So we can see that perhaps those who control the material can control the technology. So it is very important that depending upon this. And here in today's part, we are going to discuss the about the nanoparticles and their introduction, synthesis, characterization, applications, and their different types. So why the question is there? Why nano? So all of we wants nano, or people wants nano. Nano means small. As we know, nanoscale materials can have properties and that are unrealizable to the bulk materials. So bulk material is different, and the that nano size materials are different on the surface. So when the thing is small, they show as or we can say that as the material changes the size, there is a change in number of properties, and so making the material nanoscale, they show the change in melting point or melting temperature, magnetization, and structure, chemical reactivity, and many more properties are there. They show the changes as the size change. That we are going to see in the next. And so this nanoscience is the branch. It is also, we can say that it is a interdisciplinary science which deal with the different branches of discipline: chemistry, biology, biotechnology, engineering, like that. And as we know, there are the different. This is the one slide which shows how this nanotechnology is useful, and these are the areas where we can use this nanotechnology in different areas: medicine, aerospace, information. So different areas are there where we can use this nanotechnology concept. And here, what is now nano size? All of we know what is nano size. And nano means is taken from the Greek word, that is nano, meaning is that dwarf. It is the prefix used before, that is the 1 billionth of the something. And now we can express this nano size as a 10 to the power minus 9 is a nano, and this is the scale. We can convert from meter to millimeter, then millimeter to micrometer, micrometer to the nanometer. This is the conversion scales. And here we can also express how to write the nanometer: 0.000000, and that is meter. And we know that 1 billionth of the meter is 1 nanometer, and 1 nanometer is approximately the 6 carbon atom wide. Hydrogen atom is 0.1 nanometer, and humanite is 1.7 billion nanometer. So these are the about the size of this nano. As we again know that that is a nano is small, as we know, and small is powerful. Whenever the small things are there, they are very powerful, like money. Small is also sustainable. They are more stable. They do not show any change. Small is for excellent performance. Whenever the things is small, it can perform the excellence. Small is rule large, and we can say that also small is beautiful. So in this way, these are the nano size materials shown in this slide, and which are very beautiful, and they are look like a corona that have shape, cone like shape. So these are the some particles of this material. And now, what is nanoscience, or what it mean by the nanotechnology? As we know that nanoscience, in case of this particle which is having less than 100 nanometer in diameter, are said to be a nanomaterials. And the study of such type of materials is known as the nanoscience. And there is a technology which is known as nanotechnology, which design and characterize and for different application about their structure, devices, and control. They are controlling the shape and size of that material in the nanoscale. Whenever we are dealing with this nanoscience or nanomaterials, there may be some issues are there, some legal, ethical issues are there, and social ethical issues also there. And so here is a research and a development. When there is a research and development is going on, we require infrastructure, human resources, industry innovations, societal issues are there. So for national or international level, we should have to discuss about these legal and ethical things, that is about the health and safety and environmental issues and consumer protection. So this is must, because when the material come in contact with the skin, then they get absorbed. So number of that is the toxicity, or there is a problems can occur, and that is why we should have to take this care. And we have to, there's national or international level, we should have to some there be some laws or legal laws or legal or ethical this point of view we have to discuss on the international level. And now after this, as we know that there are two approaches, and these are the two great scientists. One is Richard Feynman, and he is a physicist. He got a Nobel Prize in 1965 for his fundamental work in quantum electrodynamics. And another scientist is Jean-Marie Lenz. And according to the Richard Feynman, he says he has given the top-down model for the synthesis of the nanomaterials, and Jean-Marie Lenz have given the bottom-up. And this scientist says that Richard Feynman is the scientist. He says that there are plenty of room at the bottom, and Jean-Marie says that there are plenty of room at the top. Now here, as we know, this is the bulk material, and then it is cut or slices into small part, and after that we get the nanostructure material. Now we can here another approach from the bottom to up. Here we can take the atom and atom, or molecule and molecules, or we can take the cluster and cluster, so that we get the nanostructure material. And so important thing is that here, as they have suggested, there are plenty of room at the bottom, or there are plenty of room at the top. It indicates that, as we know that one room is there, we can divide it into two parts. At this room can also be divided into four parts, or it can be divided into many parts as per the requirement. So only one room is there, but we can divide it, and therefore they say that there are plenty of rooms at the bottom or top. And meaning is that, so that this is the beauty of this nanomaterial, that material is a small one, but have plenty of rooms, and they can accommodate, they can store many things as compared to other materials. Now there are different types of materials, as we know that, and these materials are zero dimensional, two-dimensional, three-dimensional. And as we know that zero-dimensional, in case of this, the material is nanoparticle. But in case of one-dimensional, in case of this nanomaterials, there is a one dimension is outside the nanoscale. And this type of one-dimensional material include nanotubes, nanowires, nanorods, like that. In case of two-dimensional, it is very important, and research is going on the two-dimensional. In two-dimensional nanomaterial, two dimensions are outside the nanoscale, and two-dimensional nanomaterials are composed of thin layers that may have thickness of at least one atomic layer. These atoms have different functions than internal atoms, and so increase in the number of surface atom, it leads to the change in the behavior and of the 2D materials. And in case of the three-dimensional material that are not conformed to the nanoscale at in any direction. So these are the different dimensions of this material. Now there is a question, why do we want to make things small? To make the product smaller, cheaper, and also what is that for scaling them to down, and useful for electronics, catalyst, water purification, and to introduce new physical phenomena for the science and technology. As we know that mobile chips are now day by day are smaller and smaller, and also there are so many materials by using these nanomaterials. The many things are there that are in a now in a show. That is nowadays our TV, or so many things are there. That is there are small things can contain large number of data, and that is why now the capacity of the storage of that is the used by these silicon chip, other than silicon chip, the nanomaterial can store more data, as we have seen in case of the mobiles. And so that is why we require the things small. And now changes in the properties also changes the nano region. And here three approaches have been shown: quantum mechanical behavior, increase the surface area, molecular recognition, and like that. And here, as we know that new technical physics through changes in a color, transparency, hardness, magnetism. So quantum mechanical behavior shows these are the changes in the behavior. So, and here as increase in the surface area, they show the chemical process, and there is a changes in melting point, boiling point, chemical reactivity, and catalytic activity. And in case of molecular recognition, and in case of bioapplications, they show the changes in self-organization, repeatability, and adaptability. These are the here, and it is useful in a biological sciences. Now here, four important causes of this site change, and these are the seven properties. They show the changes, in the their properties as the site change. And first of all here, we are going to see here the as the site changes causes the change in color. As we know, bulk gold is a golden in color, have a melting point 1064 degrees Celsius, and the color is golden. But now when the size of this gold is in nano size, then they show the different colors. So this is one example of nano gold, and here if it is a nano 1 nanometer size, then it show the color brownish yellow, shown is the color here. And when these are 20 nanometer, then color of this material is a red in color. And if it is a 100 nanometer size particle, then the show purple or pink color like that. So here purple color, different colors are there. So depending upon the size of that material, they show the change in properties. And next is the some nanomaterials can also be obtained by using antimicrobial, fungal, algae, yeast, and also some obtained from this fungal or yeast. And we obtain from this nano triangle, nano rods, nano spheres, nano stars. These are the materials which are in nano size, can be obtained from this fungal or bacteria algae. Here one is also shown here the as the this is cadmium, selenium, indium, phosphorus, and here as the nanometer size is 4, what is the color is shown here 4.2 4.8 5.5. so how the color changes is one of the example of cadmium, selenium, and these two solutions. And again now here another that is the change in the property, that is the nano size changes the chemistry. As here nano gold is shown, this is the metal oxide surface, this is the smaller in size, this is the bigger in size. And when the reaction is taking place on the surface of this material, small size and large size, then there is a elution of this carbon monoxide in case of the bigger and larger size particle. When it is a smaller size, then there is a evolution of carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. So this have also been paper have been published by CNR of best scientists in the Chemical European Journal in 2002. So size changes the chemistry also. Now we are going to see the synthesis of nanomaterials and different here methods are there. And first here main two approaches are there, and that is the top down and bottom up. In case of top down approach, we have to start from it, cut it in a proper way, and we get the nanoparticle size. And another bottom up, so here we have to take the atom on atoms or molecule and molecule, and all we get then cluster, and from the cluster we get the nano size particles. So these are the two important approach for this synthesis of nanomaterials. But in addition to this, there are number of methods, modern methods are there for the synthesis of these materials. And this synthesis of these nanomaterials, as we have seen, top down approach is nothing but the physical methods, and bottom up approach is the chemical methods. And chemical methods, all these are the modern methods. For soldier is a common method, hydrothermal methods, number of methods are there. And these are the mechanical and chemical. And one more method is there, that is the green synthesis by using a plant extract, fungal, bacteria. By using this also, it is possible to synthesize the nanomaterials. So one method for synthesis of green method for the preparation of these metal nanoparticles, gold nanoparticles, silver nanoparticles, zinc oxide, number of metal oxide can be synthesized by using the plant extract used for this biosynthesis of nanomaterials. So first of all, it depends upon the size, also depend upon the nature of plant, its concentration of the metals are used for the extract, and the pH, temperature, all these are the conditions required. And nanoparticle using the plant extract simply by mixing with the solution with the salt at the room temperature. So this is very important, dissolution of this extract in the metal salt. These are some plant, neem, aloe vera, tea, other medicinal plant from which we can synthesize nanoparticle. And these are very important, easily available. Already the work is done, but now also in the similar way we can extract nanomaterial from the other plant which are medicinal. Now here one method is given here, that is a Sol-Gel process for the sequence here. And as you know that there are different steps as the time process here shown the seven steps: mixing, casting, gelation, edging, dyeing, all these are the process, and this is the common method for the synthesis of nanomaterials. So start from the sol and gel here, and at the last we get a tensile. This process is a wet chemical technique used for this fabrication of both glassy and ceramic material, and this process use either chemical solution, sol solution, or colloidal particle, that is sol for nanoscale particle, to produce the that is the gel. After drying process, liquid phase is to be removed from the gel, and this sol is liquid at a colloidal solution, and gel can be described as a solid or semi solid. Sol can be converted into gel by the cooling, and gel can be converted into sol by the cooling heating. So in this way, this is the common method for the synthesis of these nanoparticles. And another method are the solo thermal synthesis. This is also very good method for the synthesis of nanomaterials. And this method is also typical wet chemical synthetics method, using water or organic solvent as a reaction medium in a sealed vessel, generally the autoclave, in which the temperature range we have to maintain 100 to 240 degrees Celsius. This method show the better than other methods, and precursor, depending upon the precursor, solution is generally the nano, that is non-aqueous medium we have to use. And this method has been used for the in the laboratory to make the nanostructure titanium dioxide or graphene or other carbon spheres or other materials. And third method is also there, hydrothermal method. And in this hydrothermal method, this is also performed in a solvent like water. And in this case, this method include various techniques of crystallizing the substance from high temperature aqueous solution at high vapor pressure. This method is synthesis of single crystal that depends upon the solubility of the hot water under high pressure. The crystal growth is also preferred sometime in autoclave, in which the nutrient is supplied. And here, temperature gradient is important and to be maintained, and hotter end of the here. And temperature can be used up to 300 degrees Celsius in this method. So these are some methods of synthesis. One more method, that is I have found that this is the slow combustion process. And by using this process, as we know, for a long time, if you keep the lamp, and here, this is the part where the carbon gets accumulated, and now after 1 month, you can see there is a layer of this carbon black, and after analyzing, it is observed that this is also the nano size. So this is the slow combustion process for the synthesis of this nano material. So in case of solo thermal synthesis, we have studied this tungsten oxide, and morphology changes with the change of solvent. The method is, we have to change the solvent. So in pure ethanol, we get this type of nature. In the mixed solvent, we get this type also, different in water. And so the changes are there with the change of solvent. Now there are some methods of after synthesis, the characterization of this nanoparticle, same term, XIFM, BET methods are there to know the particle size of the synthesized material. And now here, this is the same, and same give the method of analysis of this material, and same is a scanning electron microscopy, and it gives the that is a surface morphology of the material, and also it gives the particle size. And in case of same, it is an electron microscope that image the sample surface by scanning it with the high energy beam of electrons. So by using this same, this is a very good technique to know the particle size on the surface of the material. And another method, that is the TEM, transmission electron microscopy, it is very good, and it gives the complete morphology of the particle on the surface as well as on the whole inside the body of that material. And in case of TEM, is a microscopic technique whereby beam of electron transmitted through an ultra thin specimen interact with the and passes through the sample, and electron beam illuminate the sample, and transmitted beam is a image. So in this way, after passing this, the image is obtained, and which gives the complete information about the morphology of that material. Another technique is the AFM. We for using the atomic force magnetometer, also the particle size can be we can determine or we can know. And when there is a tip, this tip shows when we touch with that surface of that metal oxide or particle, then it gives the particle size. So this is the arrangement of this AFM, and here we have to, there is a one tip of the AFM we have to touch, and we know from that part whether it is in nano size or not. And X-ray diffraction is a common method to know the particle size after doing some calculation, and by using this error formula also to know the particle size after calculation. Here we have to find out the beta and also the theta. After the knowing all these value, we can calculate the particle size here, thickness of that crystalline material. So these are the methods, and now some methods are there, that is the carbon nanotubes. And in case of carbon nanotube, when we are dealing with the material that is nano size, and when we are dealing with the nanotechnology, we should have to know the carbon nanotubes. And with the changes of the structure, there are changes in the different chemical and physical properties depending upon the size of material. And in case of the small material, in which strong chemical bonding present, where delocalization of electrons are extensive, and therefore extent of delocalization vary with the size. And therefore there are two types of carbon nanotubes, and one is a single walled and second is a multi walled carbon nanotubes. And in case of single walled and multi walled carbon nanotubes, we have this in the next slide is shown. Before going to see that here, there are different allotropes of carbon, and diamond, graphite, fullerene and graphene are the, and this is the carbon nanotube. All are contain the carbon, and so these are the different allotropes of this carbon. And we are now we know that there are two types of carbon nanotubes, and one is a single walled carbon nanotube, second is a multi walled carbon nanotubes. And now single walled carbon nanotubes are defined as a one dimensional cylindrical shape allotropes of carbon that have high surface area, and this material are special class of carbon known as the one dimensional material. They consist of sheets of graphene and one atom thick. So single walled is there, but multi walled carbon nanotubes are more useful, and multi walled carbon nanotubes are elongated cylindrical nano objects made of sp2 carbon. And their sp2 is there, carbon is in sp2 hybridization state. Their diameter is 3 to 30 nanometer, and they can grow several centimeter long. It is a allotropes of carbon again, and have high aspect ratio, means length to diameter ratio. It is also called double or triple walled carbon nanotubes. And after this, now these are very useful. And carbon nanotubes are generally three types: armchair, zigzag and chiral, shown here in this slide. That these are the three different types of carbon nanotubes, and their properties are also different. And here is a calculation to these carbon nanotubes. And in the next slide now, here after synthesis also, there is one method, different methods of synthesis of carbon nanotubes. One is a electric arc discharge, CVD method, and laser ablation. And CVD method is the very useful method for this synthesis of carbon nanotubes. Here is the arrangement of this CVD method is shown, and by using this CVD method, carbon nanotubes can be synthesized. And here is a arrangement in this way. Here is a reservoir, generally the ferrocene, dissolving benzene or toluene can be we have to use here. Here is a carrier, generally the argon, we have to pass from this. And here the K-type thermocouple is we have to use here. Here is shown, and here is the exhaust gases are there. So by using all these are the solution flow rate 3 ml per minute. So these are the conditions, and then the solution from the reservoir we have to pass, and then it interact here. Here is shown, and we get the particle. So in by using this method, nano carbon tubes, and CVD is the most widely used method for carbon nanotube synthesis. Laser ablation method is also there. In for the purpose, for this purpose, metal nanoparticles are mixed with the catalyst support such as magnesium oxide or aluminium oxide, and to increase the surface area for higher yield of the catalytic reaction of carbon feedstock with the metal particles. And the procedure is shown here to get the carbon nanotubes. And so in the next slide now, these are the some properties of carbon nanotubes. As we know, zigzag is a metal panels, carbon nanotubes are there, armchair, and these are the general semiconductors. So these are the three types and their properties have been shown here. And number of applications are there, carbon nanotubes are very more, these are the area where it can be used, nano composites, we can make nano composites, film, biotechnology, these are the some area for water filters and transistor, for purification of water, or for different purpose, for packaging also, there are number of application of these carbon nanotubes. The carbon nanotubes can be used for this badminton racket, or also this is the tennis ball racket. Because of that, it is a weight is a light, and therefore it can be used in this tennis racket. For the body of this bicycle also, carbon nanotubes are used. Therefore, nowadays the bicycles are coming with a light weight. And now this nanocarbon tube can also be used as a bulletproof jacket, and which are useful for the soldiers. And therefore, one scientist, that Professor Zhang at the University of Sydney, he invested this brilliant resistant textile using these carbon nanotubes, and which is known as a bulletproof here. And important characteristics of these materials are they manipulate the light to make the soldier invisible, purges building in sensors of soldiers, physical condition of location, view radio communication directly into the uniform fabric, provide chemical and biological protection. So this is much more useful for the soldiers, and so we can say that carbon nanotubes are very, very important for us. And these are the some mechanical properties and of these materials shown here, young models, different properties of the gold nanoparticles. Now, application of carbon nanotubes used for the develop the flat screen television with higher resolution than our human eye can detect. And our next TV screen should be thin ultralight and foldable, so we can carry that TV from one place to other place, very thin, like a paper, book paper. And badminton racket, tennis racket can also be used for that carbon nanotubes. And there is also in solar cell can also be used these nanocarbon tubes, and in a solar cells, and also signal in the square, in a traffic square, that is the three lights are there, yellow, green and red, for that signals, for that this material can also be used, and very useful carbon nanotubes are there, a number of applications are there. And one example is given here, that this is the plain cement, coated cement, and in another we have mixed the single wall carbon nanotube, and another we have mixed the that is the multi wall carbon tube. So it is observed that these are the nature of this material, and it is observed that 30% efficiency increases of this cement by addition of multi wall carbon tube. In addition of single wall, slight increases there, but addition of multi wall, there is a increase of efficiency of this material cement. So this is the nanogold, commonly known, and these are the properties of this nanogold. They show the different colors. When in a bulk, it is golden, but they show the changing color. They also show some changes in the temperature, and these are some properties of this material. And in case of important property of gold nanoparticle is that catalytic property. As we know that the particle is in a nano size, the surface area is more, and because of the more surface area, therefore this gold, nano gold is a very good catalyst for many chemical reactions. And as now here two shape is also shown in case of nano gold. When it is a bulk, then it has face center cubic structure. When it is in a nano size, then icosahedral shape is there. So they show the changes in shape, and also show the change in the catalytic properties. So this is the nanogold catalyst. Because of the particle size is smaller and a larger surface area, they show good catalytic activity. And now here, nanogold also used for the drug delivery, and because here is shown how it is injected. This is the gold nanoparticle. This nanoparticle and drug is injected to the infected part of that. Then that drug goes to the repair that that is the part in infected part. And after that, this particle get digested because it is DNA based. And so multi drug can also be loaded. So it is useful for the medical purpose, and also it found many applications in the medical field. So for drug delivery, these carbon nanotubes are very more important. Another important compound is a silver nanoparticle, as we know, and by green silver nanoparticle can be synthesized by green method and by reduction with sodium borohydride. And this is the reaction: silver nitrate react with the sodium borohydride and forming silver is forming, and a half molecules of hydrogen, half molecule here B2S6 and sodium nitrate. So here, by using this silver is obtained from the green synthesis method of this and from the neem extract and terpenoid Fresenius reducing agent by we have to use here. So this is the silver silver nanoparticles we obtained, and they show the, see the colors here, from light yellow to the brownish color. So with the change of this size, they also show the changes in color. And these are the applications of these silver nanoparticles. It is having number of applications and different field for biosensing, antioxidative, water treatment, cosmetics, antibacterial, antifungal, like that. So these are the slides show how the silver nanoparticles can be used. Here, this is the another property of silver nanoparticles. Can be used, and here silver nanoparticles may agglomerate. In order to avoid agglomeration, nanocomposite can also be synthesized, and so here nano silica used with this silver nitrate, we get this composite material. And here these composite materials are very effective against the pathogenics. And here is shown here nano silica compositions are shown 0.1 milligram per liter ml 0.25. So as the composition increases, their killing of efficiency also increases. So if two pathogens are here, bacteria E. coli and P. aeruginosa, so they show how here is equal, but now here this is having less, but killing efficiency of this C is more. So this is the chart shows the killing efficiency of this by composite material. This silver nanoparticle can also be used now in a washing machine and also refrigerator. As nowadays, this silver is written on the washing machine silver spin, and this is very effective because it remove the bacteria and odor, and for it is used for the sterilization and sterilize and to remove the bacteria and odor. And this silver nanoparticle can also be used here embedded in the cotton bandages useful for the, and here in a hand gloves also, and here in a embedded also in a polymer fabrics for NJ apron, and which are the dirt repellent also. So these are the useful, and this there also changes in the magnetic properties, and by using a nano size material, magnetic properties, that is they show the various changes. And in case of magnetic property, storage capacity of these materials are much more, are 1000 times greater than the silicon chip or other materials, and therefore it is widely used in the because it is in a small devices in of small size, used in a cell phone, credit card or microwave devices. So you know, mobile chips or you know credit card chips, this is made up of nanomaterials now, or small small is a chips is there, and show the magnetic properties. And so there is a much changes in the materials. As the size changes, they show change in the magnetic properties. Now here I'm going to discuss the important part of this material and four applications that here we are showing the impact on the society. And these are four important areas, that is, one is a stain resistant cloth, second is a technology better data storage for computation, healthcare and environment. So this shows these nanomaterials or nanoscience show the effect or impact on the society, and these are the four applications where we can here. And first, number one is the material, that is the stain resistant cloth, and it is observed that nanofiber create a cushion of air around fabric, and 10 nanometer carbon viscous bond with the cotton act like a pitch fudge, many liquid roll off. And this is the stain. Suppose stain is there on this cloth, then it can be removed if you use the nano paint, this nano paint that refuses the stain liquid. And here these are the stain after sometimes, suppose any juices, vegetables, mustard oil, after 30 minutes remove it by just pushing it and by the paper or any the material. So if you are using the fabrics of this nano size materials, then it remove the, it is a dirt repellent, it is, and the stain can be removed easily on the surface of that cloth. So this is one of the important things, that a stain resistant cloth is coming also in a, now in the future. Another important application of this material is a paint that does not chip. This is the Mercedes covered shown here. It is a very shiny, and this Mercedes is a water and dirt repellent, and because there is a nano paint used on this car, and there is no scratches, and this is also a resistant to the chipping and scratches, and they should also give the bright color, and it may also change the color in the future. So like that. So as per the requirement, that material should be changing color. So thus this car may self repair the scratches, or the color can change, and it depends upon the paint that we use, that is called nano paint. So the nano paint can be used for this purpose. Another environmental application of this, and showing the impact here, it reduces the pollution. And in case of this, as we know, here is a tall building of the world's in Dubai, what is Burj Khalifa, and on this there is a nano paint have been used on the building, and therefore there is no any crashes, or there is no any effect of environment. And why? Because it reduces the pollution, and that is in case of the, when this nano paint exposed to the UV light, then titanium dioxide present in the nanoparticle that break down the organic and inorganic pollutant and wash off during the rain. And also it decomposes the air pollution, and particle like formaldehyde can, formaldehyde is a majority is present in the air. It can also be decomposed by using this nano paint. So this nano paint is very important and useful for this as a building as a air purifier. Another environmental application is there, that is the nano solar cells. Nano solar cells also been can also be used here. This is the glass electrode, and here this nano rods and electrode. These are electrogen electrode. Here is the sunlight. When it comes, they produce the energy, and this is the alternative source of energy. This is the nano chip, and by using these nano solar cells, also embedded in the plastic, can be painted on the bus or roof, buses or the roof cloth, and then that become a cheaper. It is a cheaper source of energy, so we can run the bus or train also sometimes small vehicles on these nano solar cells in the future. So this is the sandwich between the two electrodes actually here, and we have to use this nano cell and inorganic nano rod embedded in this semiconducting polymer, and it is a sandwich between the two electrodes, and this nano solar cell can be used for different ways, and can be useful in the future also. And another application of this showing the impact on the society, that as we know, CD contains small storage capacity. DVD has much larger as compared to CD. Silicon chip have again more capacity as compared to other CD and DVD. But the this nano material chips is having a 1,000 times more storage capacity as compared to other. And here, 1 lakh times greater storage capacity have been absorbed by using this nano size material for the chips. And in the last, I can say that challenges to the academic institution. So many challenges are there. So many areas are there where we can we can do the research. So many areas are there. We can use the clean synthesis method, and different areas are there for to work for. And therefore, there are the challenges to the academic institute. And our ex-president Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, he says that creativity leads to thinking, and thinking provides knowledge, and knowledge makes you great. This is a very good quote given by our ex-president Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And he says that there are many areas of research of nano science or nanomaterials, or in case of nanotechnology. And one area is that is the we can also make the nano, that is nano robot. That is the one of the one field to develop the nano robot. And in also nanorobot have number of application for repairing the body, infected part of the body, because when it is injected, it go to the part of the body, and after repairing that part, it then digested in the because it is DNA base. And so here, with this, I stop here. Thank you for all you kind attention. And as we seen different aspect and fundamental basic concept of this nano materials here. And here, participant also asked one question, and the question is that what is the future of nanotechnology or curing the COVID-19? Another question is that use of nanomaterial in a corona prevention. As we know that there is a no, this answer of this question is that there is no vaccine or the specific treatment for COVID-19 at present. This is the disease caused by severe respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, and it is a clown like. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, we
yes,
are
sir.
Audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, as we know, we are facing this problem of COVID-19, and this corona, as we know, that the shape of this corona is a clown like shape, and particle size of that corona is a 125 nanometer. And we can also synthesize the nanomaterial and of a smaller size. And definitely the scientists are using, doing research for that, and work is going on. And Thomas Webster, Northeastern Chemical Engineer, they are doing research on this, and making the, developing the nanoscale medicines also. And now for this disease and other viruses also, and they shows that these nanoparticles and nanotechnology are much useful for this COVID-19 also, and because they show the particle size smaller, larger surface area, and this technology uses, as we know that in the COVID-19, this RT-PCR, this is the technique that is RT is using reverse transcription for converting the RNA into the DNA. And after that, this PCR using for detection of these images of that DNA. So the papers are going on, and work is also going on. And one scientist from the Mumbai University, that is Dr. Patil, have synthesized antiviral coating material based on the nanomaterials. It is stable and low cost material. So research is going on this, and we hope that the vaccine or some medicine may come early as. So, and also another question was there, but so because of the time, okay. Hello? Hello?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Hello, Vikram.
Yeah, hand over to Dr. Vivek Sharma. Hand over to Dr. Vivek Sharma.
माइक ऑन नहीं है सर आपका माइक म्यूट है सर विवेक सर
Ladies and gentlemen, after the speaker to ends his session, we have a short panel discussion, because we have had more than 700 questions. We cannot answer all, but few questions will be answered by the speakers. It is my pleasure to introduce speaker number 2, Professor Sanjay Dahal, who is currently Professor and Head Department of Chemistry, Sikkim Manipal Institute of Technology. sir has completed his MSc from Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, and his PhD from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He is postdoctoral fellow at Tel Aviv University, Israel, and University of Notre Dame, United States of America. His main research interest is porphyrin chemistry. It is my honor to present Professor Sanjay Dalal, speaker number 2, to the House. Thank you.
Sir, आपका कैमरा ऑन कीजिए सर. दहाल सर.
It's on. It's on.
Yes sir. Yes sir.
It's on. Okay. I'll share the slide, then I'll talk.
सर योर कैमरा भी नहीं आ रहा है सर. पीपीटी भी नहीं आ रहा है. कैमरा ऑन करना है सर.
अभी ऑन अभी आ रहा है. जस्ट चेक इट आउट.
नहीं आ रहा सर.
आई जस्ट सेव्ड इट. इट्स विजिबल इन माय स्क्रीन. देयर इज सम नेटवर्क इशू आई बिलीव.
पीपीटी विजिबल सर. पीपीटी विजिबल.
इट इज विजिबल ना.
यस सर. यस सर. यस सर. इट इज विजिबल.
Then you I can go ahead, right?
Yes, sir, you can continue.
Yeah. I welcome again everyone to this webinar, and especially students. I will try to talk about porphyrin. It's a molecule which is ubiquitous in nature, and the nature has really taken advantage of this tetrapyrolic molecule, basically. Perform diverse function, and I will. It's not possible in a period the whole chemistry of porphyrin, but I will touch upon some popular applications of porphyrin and the basic chemistry behind the porphyrin molecule. Okay, I'll just browse to the slides first. What do all the single You are not able to see?
Now we can see the screen, yes.
Yeah? Okay. Can I go
ahead
now?
Yes, we can see the screen.
Okay. Is it okay now? Can I proceed?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay. So, I'll just come to some of the slides which I'll just be browsing through. Like, what are the common in these slides? Look at the wonderful car. Then we have somebody doing a dental surgery, then we have a laser treatment, then we have some scanning going on, then we have red blood cells, everybody knows about the red blood cells, then we have polymeric conjugated material, basically it's a conducting polymers, talk about the solar cells, talk about the plants itself, and we talk about huge number of catalysts which is existing. And the latest solar cells, diverse solar cells. And even for a lighter mode, about the deformities in the human being due to the problem of porphyrin metabolism. And in fact, all these pictures share a common link. Actually, all of them are related to a chemical compound known as porphyrins. Now, if you look at briefly touch at the history of porphyrins, the pathway to porphyrins essentially started with dyes which were extracted from plants called the indigo plant. Now, this indigo plant is very popular for its brilliant color, and it is not faded so easily. And in fact, this purple was known as a royal purple color. Now, porphyrins, how were it discovered? In fact, like many of molecules, porphyrins also were discovered by accident. In 1897, a new German company started manufacturing the indigo dye synthetically instead of extracting from the natural products. because the synthetic processor gave you a cheaper product. Now, another company also was trying to make a modified indigo, and instead of getting that typical indigo color, they were getting a purple byproduct, and in fact, that was contaminating their expected desired product. Now, these impurities also were brilliantly colored, and on top of that, it was very, very robust in the sense that could withstand, whereas most are so invariant. And if you look at the basic chemical structure of porphyrin molecules, it consists of four pyrrole units that are linked by this methane bridges, and I have four nitrogens, and I have, when I have the two hydrogens, it will be called as a free base. And instead of the two hydrogens, if I have a metal in the center, then all the four nitrogens are connected with the metal, and that is known as metalloporphyrins. And in nature, we find large variety of metalloporphyrins that is going to perform differently. And not only that, the periphery of porphyrin are where you have different substitution. So we can substitute with different groups. Again, they add to the fine-tuning of the properties of the porphyrin. And in fact, this porphyrin contains 22 pi electrons, but at a given time, only 18 pi electrons are in conjugation. And everybody knows in chemistry that if you have a large circulating electric current, it creates a large magnetic field, and any disruption in this electric current will definitely cause a change in property of the molecule. So in that sense, this porphyrin molecule becomes extremely sensitive to the chemical environment or the surrounding environment. Why porphyrins are cool? Now, first of all, they are really big. Now, I already touched upon, they can actually can have all the metal ions of the periodic table almost. There are some difficult to introduce in the core, some are very easy to introduce in the core. And I talked about the conjugation, 18 pi conjugated system alternating single and double bonds, so that makes the system very, very stable. That's why it does not degrade at high temperature also. And since we have a large number of metal ion in the core and large number of substituents on the periphery, as a result of which the property changes dramatically, and hence they are able to adorn various roles in the real world. And since they have so many uses in the nature, these molecules have been extensively investigated and modeled in order to understand the natural phenomena as well as to construct new materials which will be useful for the society. Now, in gist, if I look at the uses of porphyrins because of its unique chemistry, some of them which I can list is as a metal binder. So porphyrin is a very good ligand. You can bind almost every metal. Is used in dye solar cell, so conversion of light to chemical energy. And if you talk about the oxygen transport, it's hemoglobin. When you talk about storage, it is myoglobin. Electron transfer medium in conducting polymers. And if you talk about the natural, it is the cytochromes. We have the porphyrins performing function in gene regulation, drug metabolism, iron metabolism, hormone synthesis, photosensitizers, so on and so forth. The list is very, very exhaustive. Okay, we have porphyrins, combination, conjugates with various sophisticated molecules from nanoparticles to polymers to several other different molecules, and performing, enhancing the properties of them. So, on essence, porphyrin are molecules. If you take a porphyrin and if you try to use in any field, you are able to use it, and in essence, why you are able to use it is basically the 18 pi conjugated electrons. This is the main heart of a porphyrin. This is what provides its beautiful role in the nature. Now, let's revisit hemoglobin. We know it's a tetrameric molecule. and exhibiting a cooperative effect in binding of oxygen. And these are the protoporphyrin 5-in-9, also known as. Okay, and the iron over here can. At the sixth position is where the oxygen is going to get coordinated. And look at the nature, chlorophyll. Chlorophyll essentially contains magnesium. And there are changes in the side. As I take away one double bond, what it gives is, it essentially gives is a very large extension coefficient in the visible range. That means I am able to absorb the visible light very efficiently. And this is what has taken advantage by the nature in terms of a chlorophyll and the light harvesting. Now in the electron transport, we have a copper porphyrin, which are cytochromes. In catalysis in nature, we have cytochromes. P450, coenzyme 5, 430, we have vitamin B12, and in the case of iron in the center, we have hemoglobin. So essentially, if you look at the molecule, there are four prolyunits, some modification here and there, change the metal atom, slightly change the side arms. Now you have diversely performing molecules, and the list goes endless. You can do a lot of changes and you can have different type of functionality using the same basic molecule. Now this is a mitochondrial electron transport. I think this is already a school chemistry, and cytochrome C is a molecule that is responsible for transporting and in fact for the energy production in a cell. And if you talk about the photovoltaics, if you talk in the direct use during the daytime, then you basically use as a storage for a few cells that will be used for a night. This is just an introduction that it has a diverse use. Now, I will specifically touch upon this particular chemistry of porphyrin, that is the excited state chemistry of a porphyrin derivatives, and how it is useful to society. Now, porphyrin derivatives able to take porphyrin, all conjugated pyrrole, chlorines, one ring reduced, or bacteriophilins, two ring reduced. Okay, these are the common porphyrin codes we talk about, and all of them have large extension coefficients in the visible range. And because of this, they are extensively applied for fluorescence imaging. Fluorescence imaging means these molecules are very, very fluorescent, and that can be used to map different parts of a body. And PTT stands for photothermal therapy. This photothermal therapy is used for treatment of malignant cells in the body or tumors, and photodynamic therapy, more older one and in use, is again used for killing the malignant cells in the body. Now, these therapeutic functions essentially are achieved by during three dissipation pathways. The excited state energy can get dissipated by three different pathways. Now, remember, for fluorescence, the molecule has to be in the excited singlet state. So any porphyrin molecule you excite, it may go to the first singlet excited state, or it can go to the second excited singlet state. It will come down to S0, then it can radiatively decay. So if it is radiatively decaying, I can use that molecule for fluorescence imaging. Now I can modulate the porphyrin in such a way through suitable substitution, I can get a very good fluorescence yield, quantum yield of fluorescence. Second is non-radiative vibrational relaxation. Now non-radiative vibrational relaxation is the one in which I'll essentially generate is heat. See, all these are quantum mechanical phenomena. Any relaxation of excited state, there has to be an harmony how it is going to get relaxed. So there are a large number of vibrational modes through which it can come down to ground state by non-radiative vibrational relaxation. And the heat generated is essentially used for phototherapy therapy of immune cells in the body. The third one is, from the singlet state, if there is an intersystem crossing to a triplet state, and since triplet state is a forbidden state, it will be long-lived because of the forbidden nature, and from the triplet state, it emits a radiation called phosphorescence. It will be known as phosphorescence now. Or, since the triplet state is long-lived, it has a chance to react, since it is long-lived. So, when it reacts with the surrounding reagents like oxygen, then basically oxygen is stable in ground state in a triplet state. Now, if the oxygen in a singlet state, now it becomes highly active. As a reactive oxygen species, it can be in other forms also, and in this essence, this is what is used for photodynamic therapy. So, in this presentation, a little bit I'll talk about your important field as far as the porphyrin molecule is concerned. Now, these are the basic structures of porphyrin. Again, I have already talked about porphyrin, chlorine, and bacterial chlorine. We have two pyrrolidine, which is reduced. And in chlorine, we have one of the pyrrolidine, one of the double bond is reduced. And this mere changing of the number of double bond gives unique property to these three basic porphyrin rings. Now, what is photodynamic therapy? Now, essentially, in medical field, it employs a combination of light and a drug which is basically able to kill the malignant cell or unwanted tissue. Even if you have a tumor which is not malignant, that also you can kill. Okay, any unwanted tissue can be killed with the help of a drug and a exposure to light. Okay, now come back with traditional treatments. When you talk about traditional treatments, we are talking about surgery and we are talking about chemotherapy. These are the two popular and still remains the most popular treatment method for cancer. But PDT and PTT is catching up slowly, and specifically in some areas they are the only way out. Okay, so PDT and PTT both will be a promising approach for an anti-cancer treatment. Now, why is PDT or PTT is important is basically you don't require any invasion. Basically, it is minimally invasive combination therapy with advantages of either very, very minimum or not damaging on normal cell or normal tissue. All the anti-cancer drugs, chemotherapy drugs, have a side effect, and there is always a great amount of research to reduce the toxicity and side effect of your cancer drugs. This is always a challenge, has been a challenge, and it still remains a challenge. A lot of research work is going in this field. The advantage of porphyrin in the anti-cancer activity. What is the advantage? Why one should study a porphyrin? Why one should use a porphyrin molecule? Number one, preferential location in cancer cells as compared to healthy cells. Now, this is a very, very big advantage. If you look at cisplatin molecule, the most popular anti-cancer drug, and still today 50% of the cancers are treated using this cisplatin drug, but they do not have a preferential location, and that what leads to killing of the healthy cells also, and hence the side effect and the toxicity. Okay, so there is the porphyrin has an inherent preference to be localized in these tumor cells. Second, already I have talked about large variety of metal ions I can put in the porphyrin gel. I can use advantage of this coordination chemistry of the metal ions. Very simple coordination chemistry I can use to modulate different type of binding phenomena. Third, multitude of ligands already I talked about in the periphery. So I will fine tune the property of the porphyrin, either your oxygen producing ability, singlet oxygen producing ability, or interaction with other molecules present in the cancer cell, because cancer cell is not only binding with the DNA, it involves so many other killing of other processes that might lead to proliferation of the cancer cells. That chemistry again is a very, very diverse and a very, very broad chemistry. Now, another advantage of this photodynamic therapy or photothermal therapy would be the low toxic side effects and very little pain. It's a very big advantage. Typically, you would inject a photosensitizer, then using an appropriate wavelength, you are going to find that light, and it will eventually lead to the tumor cell death. That is a very simple chemistry behind how the photosensitizer is going to work on a cancer cell. Mode of action, it's a repetition of what I have shown in the figure. Okay, the photosensitizer should be a very good photosensitizer able to kill the tumor cells. Okay, now in this case, our problem is if the tissue is very deep rooted inside the body, the light may not reach the tumor. Okay, so if I use the only light source as the mechanism of energizing the photosensitizer, I will be not be able to treat tumor which is deep inside the body. So one is to think about alternate ways of exciting this photosensitizer. This is the challenge. Now, how does the porphyrin have a specific location in the tumor cells? Basically, the aggregation of porphyrin cells in the cancer cells is facilitated by low density in GIST. That means the porphyrin has a property of getting localized cancer. As far as it is not right to go to an acidic environment because it will get protonated and it becomes. So this pH difference again becomes an advantage for the porphyrin as far as the diffusion of the porphyrin towards the cancer cell is related. These are some of the clinically approved photosensitizer porphyrin molecules which is in practice. Photofrin, that is used for lung cancer. Foscan, that is used to treat head and neck cancer. Then we have Lutex, that is used for skin, breast, gastrointestinal tract, and lung cancer. Tocard is what is used for prostate cancer. And hematoporphyrin is used for breast cancer, colon cancer. These are some of the clinically approved and is being used for treatment in various countries across the world. Now, what is the advantage of PDT? Although I said that PDT is a good, what is the advantage? If you want to just the advantage of pros of PDT, no long-term side effect and less cost. It takes only a certain time and, of course, can be targeted very precisely and can be repeated as many times as you want to repeat. Now, normally photosensitizers, again, one thing is porphyrin molecules are good for photosensitizers. There may be other molecules which are a good photosensitizer. Now, these molecules need to be connected with the bioactive groups which will have a more preference for the cancer cell. And this will provide a synergistic therapeutic effect in the case porphyrin and a bioactive molecule is combined. And it will improve the efficiency of the whole process. Now, combination, this is where that deep-seated tumor can be, problem of treating deep-seated tumor can be overcome is if I have a chemiluminescent substance, okay, endogenous chemiluminescent substance which is connected with the photosensitizer. Now, this chemiluminescent substance, the energy what is released can excite the porphyrin and I can treat the deep-rooted tumor with the help of this chemiluminescent species which is attached with the photosensitizer. Okay. Not only that, if you have a photosensitizer which penetrates the tissue, okay, very well, okay, this will enhance the targeting and not only that, it will increase the drug level concentration in the target site. So these are the major advantages of a photodynamic therapy. Now what are the disadvantages? It cannot be 100% advantageous. PDT can only treat areas where light can reach. So whatever the clinically approved drugs so far is concerned, they will not be able to treat if it is very, very deep rooted. PDT can't be used to cancers that have spread to too many places. White
widespread cancer cannot be treated with photodynamic therapy. You have to rely upon your chemotherapy. Now, PDT, since I'm using a photosensitizer, the people become sensitive to light after the treatment also. So one needs to take special precautions not to be exposed to the light whenever the drugs are having an active life in the body. Okay. Another restriction for PDT, it can't be used in people who have certain blood diseases. These are the certain disadvantages of PDT. Now, chemiluminescent photosensitizer, that's what I talk about, is a new way of enhancing the use of PDT into deep-rooted tumors. Okay, it will solve the problem of low penetration of ultraviolet or visible light in the biological tissues. So, this is a new area of research which is emerging. Now, photothermal therapy, this is a new area of cancer treatment. In this case, what we are focusing is, we are focusing about is a vibration which will, vibrational energy which will be produced when the excited molecule comes down to the ground state. Okay, and that energy is dissipated in the form of heat. So the heat is the major criteria here for killing the cancer cells. Okay, again it is non-invasive and it is localized phototherapy. Okay, now again it will be restricted and concentrated treatment area of light exposure. Now PTT is promising because it will be a quick recovery time and the treatment time is less, non-invasive procedure, there are advantages similar to the PDT. So in this case, I use a near infrared laser to irradiate the tumor cells. So there should be an increase in temperature. So whenever the temperature crosses a 50 degrees centigrade, then the effective killing of the cancer cells starts taking place. Now the only problem is if this heat which is being generated starts seeping to the neighboring cell, then the neighboring cell also may get damaged. So this is the only precaution one needs to take. Okay. Now there is another compound called photothermal absorbers that are also employed to elevate and concentrate the heat production in target tumor cells only. This is another mechanism. Generally, these photothermal absorbers require low light